I like learning. One of the things that I love so much about YouTube is that it gives me the ability to experiment and to learn new things. So today, in collaboration with Merck KGaA Darmstadt, Germany, I'm going to be learning to draw, or trying to, and talking a bit about what happens in our brains when we learn new things. This should be interesting. One of the curiosity metrics in Merck KGaA's 2018 Curiosity Report is joyous exploration, defined as the pleasure of seeking out new information and engaging in novel experiences, and the subsequent joy of learning and growing. I really connected to that sentiment and so set out to start learning to draw, a skill that I really admire in other people and have wanted to be better at for pretty much my whole life. Now, most of my drawings look like that of a toddler, and so I don't expect to become an expert in just a couple of weeks. This is the beginning of what will hopefully be a much longer journey, but I did want to dig into some of the science surrounding what happens in our brains when we learn new skills, in the hope that maybe I could will a little bit of that to happen in my own brain. You know how when you first start learning to do something, it's really hard and takes a lot of concentration, but then once you do it over and over, it just sort of becomes something you do without thinking? Well, I wondered if this was actually something happening at a level we could observe in our brains. I found a 2013 meta-analysis that looked at lots of different studies that used neuroimaging to investigate which parts of the brains showed activity while learning a task in healthy young adults. Some of these tasks were cognitive thinking tasks, while others were physical motor skills. They found that as participants underwent training for a specific task, the studies observed a decrease in activity in brain regions including the frontoparietal control network and the dorsal attention network, and an increase in activity in regions like the default network, which the authors state is typically suppressed during highly demanding tasks. The study also noted that high levels of activity in these default network regions had been associated with greater task ease and mind wandering. These increases in activity in the default network after training feel like they make some intuitive sense to me. Imagine a little kid learning to tie their shoes. They need to use all of their concentration to get it just right. But after years of doing this almost every day, I've gotten pretty good at tying my own shoes, and I don't have to concentrate on it very much anymore, and my brain is free to do other things. The authors hypothesize that the combination of increased default network activity and decreased frontoparietal control network activity could be a good indicator of training-related performance gains. And while this is interesting in a scenario like me learning a new skill, it could be a really important metric in areas like neurorehabilitation, which strives to help patients to recover from neurological injuries. Having indicators of when rehabilitation and training interventions are or are not working could be helpful for evaluating treatment efficacy. So this was a cool look at one of the many things that happen at a big brain level during learning, but I also wanted to take a look at what happens when we zoom in to the cellular level in the brain.
This is why I draw my animations in Illustrator.
Myelin is a fatty insulator that wraps around neuronal axons, helping to speed up the transmission of electrical signals along their lengths. Myelin is formed by cells called oligodendrocytes, and some research has found that learning a new motor skill can increase the proliferation of these cells in mice. Researchers took mice and gave them a new problem to tackle, a wheel with irregularly spaced rungs. They found that as mice learned new running strategies to conquer this complex wheel, they saw an increase in both oligodendrocytes and their precursor cells in the mouse brains. They also found that if they interfered with oligodendrocyte production in these mice, the mice had a harder time developing the skills needed to run on the complex wheel. So mice that had a reduced ability to form these new myelin-producing cells also had a reduced ability to learn this new motor skill, indicating that oligodendrocytes and myelin might be very important in the motor skill learning process. The authors hypothesize that this might be because new connections are formed, or existing connections are strengthened, between neurons in the brain when the mice learn this new motor skill, as the neurons involved in that motion fire over and over again. The increased activity in those connections might stimulate myelination of the involved cells, thereby making the circuit more efficient. So am I creating new myelin in my brain and switching to the default network as I draw? Probably not yet based on the looks of what's here in my sketchbook, But if I remain diligent and I keep up practicing and I learn the motor skills needed to control the pen, to draw straight lines and shapely circles, then maybe I will. So thank you to Merck KGaA Darmstadt, Germany for sponsoring this video. Joyous exploration is just one of the metrics measured in their new 2018 Curiosity Report. Their Curiosity Index also focuses on openness to other people's ideas, deprivation sensitivity, and stress tolerance, which I talked about in a recent video, which you can watch by clicking on the card above. You can also click on the links in the description below to explore the 2018 Curiosity Report. And as always, remember to go forth and do science.